It would not have escaped most PWM viewers and readers that many of the conversations between private bankers and their clients in recent years have been about the three interlinked topics of climate change, health, and food production. We welcome Marisa Drew, Chief Sustainability Officer at Credit Suisse, to share her insights about these themes. Hello, Marisa.
Hello, hello. Delighted to be here.
Marisa, the World Economic Forum of 2020 probably marked the first time that the climate crisis and related environmental issues were ranked among the world's top five risks by global leaders, NGOs, and academics. Is this sentiment also reflected in your client base and their investment priorities?
Without question, we have seen an enormous wall of capital wanting to get invested behind climate change mitigation. And that's only been exacerbated through the crisis, as I think the reality has set in about how interconnected things like pandemics are to the environment. And in addition to that, one of the things that we've also realized with our clients is that there's this great desire as part of when you experience climate as your own reality, whether it's you facing wildfires in your home territory or these extraordinary weather events, it's a bit of a call to action. And our clients want to use their capital to try to make change and create the better world that they want to see for future.
But there's other factors around us that are changing as well, Marisa, not least the political climate. I mean, we've got a change of political direction and administration in the US. We appear to be entering a new era in which state budgets around the world are being allocated to promoting and accelerating investment in new technologies and green infrastructure with the goal of building back better. Does this political sea change also mark a pivotal moment of opportunity for investors?
Absolutely, enormous opportunity. We always say, as just in good sound investment theory, look at where you see enabling conditions or fundamental underpinnings that should drive value. And political direction and regulatory intervention are fantastic places to follow where you can invest your capital behind those actions. So for instance, and it's not just the US, but clearly the US is being bold with the infrastructure spend that is just working its way through the political circles. But if the country, if the government is going to spend trillions in green infrastructure, as a private investor, if you're following the companies that are providing those green goods and services, you can see why there would be potential for enormous value. It just isn't limited to the US though. If you look at sometimes political statements, for instance, when China said they're going to ban petrol cars within 5 years, what did they do in just one nanosecond? They created a multi-hundred billion dollar or euro industry to invest behind EV OEM manufacturers, component parts manufacturers for energy infrastructure and EV infrastructure, all of the charging stations, et cetera. So you can see where all of this political will does create opportunities for the investor. And we often are saying that this is one of the great investment opportunities in the history of our generation to get behind climate change mitigation and all of this activity.
Because following on from what you said, it appears that the climate crisis today is at the center of everything. And most scientists would agree, Marisa, that COVID-19 is intrinsically linked to the world's climate and biodiversity emergency, largely caused by human activities and destruction of necessary ecosystems. Against a backdrop of animals being displaced from their natural habitats and food chains being disrupted, how should we be investing in sustainable food sources and products?
There's no doubt that the way we produce, consume, package, deliver, and sadly waste food is one of the biggest contributors to carbon emissions, but also to biodiversity loss. There are enormous opportunities there along that entire value chain to try to put your money behind those companies who are delivering goods and services with better outcomes. So this can range from alternatives to packaging rather than plastic, biodegradable opportunities, in regenerative agriculture, in some of these disruptive companies that are shaking up traditional food systems by delivering more sustainable models, whether it be plant-based alternatives or cell-based lab-grown food and seafood that are just at their early nascent stages of emerging to become consumer viable on our shelves. All of these types of solutions, almost by definition, because they're born out of necessity, are going to create longevity and value for the investor.
So if I can ask you more broadly, Marisa, how are food, health, and climate tied together? And what sort of measures have been developed to calculate and mitigate the carbon footprint of the food system?
Well, they're intricately interlinked, as you definitely alluded to earlier, as man-made activity is taking more and more of natural habitats away from animals. There's more interaction to people, so thus pandemic issues, but also things like that are man-made in the arena of pollution. We know pollution affects health and health affects well-being. We know those who are in more polluted cities have harder times with their own livelihoods because it's more difficult just to operate day to day, and so on and so on. So this deep connection is there. Where we stand today is that there's a tremendous amount of data that is being able to be generated now through technological innovation. So we can now map the footprint of our food systems in their entirety. We can also, through scanning technology, look at more sustainable opportunities. And we are so technologically advanced now with some of the geosatellite technology, where you can look down into 100,000 hectare fields, agricultural fields, and go down to literally one single plant and determine whether that plant needs more water or more shade. So with these types of technologies, well, not only can we map the carbon footprint, but we can also find much more efficient ways of growing our food and producing our food. And then when we think about what are the uses of the energy sources for our food production, we can rely hopefully and in due course on almost entirely green energy sources. So to fuel the food systems, and on it goes. You see, so all of these opportunities exist, which is what gets us excited and inspires us and gives us hope that we have a fighting chance of coming to a much better outcome for society at large.
So can I conclude from what you're saying that you feel it's not enough to invest in broadly sustainable food production methods, and that instead we need higher conviction portfolios, perhaps identifying specific disruptors in food and agricultural technology?
Well, certainly I think it's a little of both. Very directed and targeted investments in helping some of these earlier stage venture stage companies get off the ground is necessary, because that technological innovation will create breakthroughs for us. But equally, we also need to transition the more mature companies in the food system, help them migrate their business models to greener solution. Because if we step back and think about what in its totality will help us mitigate climate change, about a third needs to come from technological innovation. A third needs to come from process improvements. So it's those little tweaks to business models to create, to eliminate inefficiencies, or just day to day have a better carbon emission footprint. And finally, a third needs to come from our own individual choices as consumers and buyers. So our consumption habits are a piece of the equation too. And how do we drive better outcomes through the power of our consumer wallet? So all of those together are really the magic answer to the difficult question of mitigating climate change and the environment.
And in addition to the consumer habits, which you mentioned, Marisa, we've also got the labor patterns. And one thing I've noticed on my travels is how agriculture is becoming a much less labor-intensive sphere. In Eastern Europe, I've seen these self-driving tractors and combine harvesters, which can be guided from remote control rooms. How does the accompanying depopulation of the countryside and migration to cities and the increasing carbon footprint tie in with your environmentally friendly investment beliefs?
Well, certainly it is true that if you have migration from rural areas to cities, you see a much higher carbon footprint associated with that move. So city infrastructure, waste infrastructure, et cetera, is much more intensive than rural economies. On the other hand, technological innovation, some of the things that you pointed out, can also lead to better jobs. So rather than manual labor, we can upskill and create more attractive opportunities for those who want to stay in the agricultural environment. And then finally, one of the things that we're seeing is actually a reversal in many places, where people who have moved to the cities are actually asking themselves, could I have a better life without being in a polluted environment, without having the intensity of what cities all provide? And so we're in some cases seeing migration back out to rural economies. But I think this in this instance, what you're seeing is the youth who have said, maybe the city life isn't all it's cracked up to be. And when I move back out to the country and maybe inherit the family farm, I can use technology to my advantage to farm better, smarter, and I can also do it under a greener footprint. And it's very appealing, I think, to the next gen in particular, who are actually serving as a business model for us for a brighter future within agriculture.
So we're seeing everything turn full circle again. Marisa Drew, thank you so much for sharing those insights with us.